For that, Prashant Nair has, again, for the better part of the evening, been going through the 177-page report, and he's here with the details. Prashant, take us through the key highlights that stand out.
Absolutely. And, you know, mind you, these are the highlights. As it's a 170-page report. I'm going to sort of breeze through it, just picking up the most important key elements. What I've done is I've divided this into six key sort of things to watch out for. The first one basically is to do with the board and what the report says on independent directors. What it says is this, that a board should have a minimum of six directors. At least one woman should be an independent director. Basically, one independent director is a must. At least 50% of the board must be independent directors. I mean, this is important. At least 50% of the board must be comprised of independent directors. Of course, this is going to be done in a graded, gradual manner. The nomination and remuneration committee should have two-thirds independent directors. That's the composition. The maximum number of directorships has been cut to seven. Detailed reasons for resignations by directors and independent directors have to be provided. Minimum quorum rules in terms of when board meeting happens, what's the minimum number of board of directors which need to be present has been strengthened. They've also said that disclosure on expertise that directors possess also needs to be made public. There is also this important point, the separation of the roles of between the chairperson and CEO MD, which has also been done with. I think there's been a fair bit of discussion on this. Okay, let's get to the next big kind of focus area of this report, which is group monitoring. And we're talking about conglomerates, I mean, companies with various businesses, etc. It says that audit committee needs to scrutinize use of funds by any subsidiary of the group above a certain threshold. It kind of defines that, the threshold in the report. It calls for dedicated group governance unit to be created. It says that the threshold for determining what is a material subsidiary is now to be considered as 10% of consolidated income or 10% of the net worth of the group, basically. It also says that all unlisted Indian material subsidiaries need to undertake audits. Let's come to the third point, which is related party transactions. Again, something which has been a huge focus area. Just two or three important points here. New provision for reclassification of specific promoters has been introduced. I mean, we kind of saw a fair bit of talk about this around the time that Infosys story was playing out earlier this year. Related party can vote against a related party transaction. Right now, related parties could not vote. But right now, under the new proposal, related party can vote against, if they wish, a transaction. Royalty payouts which exceed 5% of the total turnover of the company need specific shareholder approval. This is important. Again, will impact companies. Let's come to the annual report. Details of material changes with explanation must be given. Disclose medium and long-term strategy. Yeah. An annual report needs to be submitted to stock exchanges within 48 hours. Next, you come to strengthening audit quality. Again, important. This will be a little bit of controversy as well. SEBI, it says, to have power to act against auditors in listed companies. Okay. SEBI to have powers to act against auditors and other fiduciary bodies. Consolidated results have to be filed quarterly. And last but not the least, the role of investors. It says AGM must be held within 5 months from the closure of the financial year. E-voting must be kept open for longer on the meeting date. AGM webcasts need to be broadcast at least for the top 100 companies.
Okay, Prashant, thanks for taking us through that detailed takeaway. Joining in now to discuss this further is Amit Tandon of IIAS, who is also a member of the Corporate Governance Panel, as well as another member of the Corporate Governance Panel, Joydeep Sengupta. He's also a senior partner at McKinsey & Company. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining in on the show. Joydeep, coming to you first. I want to stress on the point that Prashant made on the related party transaction. Take us through the changes that this will essentially bring in, and what was the thought behind putting this into place? Is it to ensure the transparency? Is it to ensure the position of the promoters is more clear-cut?
So thank you. Thank you for having me on this. I think the basic principle, if you think about related party transactions, comes from the fact that one of the core pillars of corporate governance that we really wanted to emphasize is protection of minority shareholders. And in the Indian context, as you think about large promoter-led companies, often we find that, you know, there are many related party transactions which occur, which do not necessarily take into account the interests of the minority shareholder. And therefore, the recommendations around that are very much to create the checks and balances. to make sure that, you know, those are pretty much in place. And I think that's been the spirit behind the related party transaction recommendation.
Amit, the related parties can vote against a related party transaction. I mean, they can't vote in favor, but they can now vote against.
Absolutely. There were instances where a few related parties said that, look, we are not voting in favor of the transaction, but surely we have the right to vote against a transaction. And therefore, that provision was kind of giving them a little bit more flexibility with regard to certain transactions.
This point about SEBI to have power to act against auditors in listed companies, is this likely to prove a little contentious, Mr. Sengupta?
It certainly will. And in some sense, I think again, if you go back to the spirit of this, it is to say that, look, you can put in greater protection for shareholders. And one of the things, as the regulator, it needs to have the power, if you may, to enforce some of these recommendations. And I think that's the spirit behind the point that, look, should there be real gross negligence, then SEBI will have the power to act against the auditors.
Amit, was the spirit behind this essentially to increase the scrutiny and transparency for auditors? And it's not just the related party transactions. There have been other areas with respect to group monitoring where audit committees have increased transparency and increased responsibility now.
Absolutely. You know, if you take a step back and, what Prashant spoke about and what Joydeep has said, the two essential gatekeepers as far as public markets are concerned. One is the directors, and the second is the auditors. And in both of these, what you've seen is that SEBI has worked towards strengthening the roles and responsibilities of the directors, as well as provided greater oversight to them. They've done the same with the auditors, saying that you're responsible for group companies, not just what is happening at the parent entity. You need to be scrutinizing transactions. One of the things, which is actually, in a sense, it's relatively small, but you can't disregard with where it said that, look, in case you're not happy with when you're looking at, let's say, trying to put a number at a particular transaction, if you're not happy with it, you can actually, the auditor has the right to hire an external consultant,
yeah,
which would be paid for by the company.
Yeah.
So there are a number of small steps. And given the fact that auditors are important gatekeepers as far as the market is concerned, their role has been strengthened. But look, with all there also needs to be greater oversight over their functioning, which is why SEBI has decided that for listed companies. So therefore, you need to make a distinction between saying that SEBI will kind of prevent any auditor from auditing to saying that, look, this is with regard to listed companies. And if I may,
yes,
in a sense, it's no different. RBI also does this with regard to banks.
Mm. Okay, fair enough.
You've kind of got it here. So it should not actually, in a sense, be something new to the audit profession.
Okay, fair enough. I just have a couple of specific points. At least 50% of the board must be comprised of independent directors. Of course, it's going to be done gradually, Amit. But where do we stand now? I mean, I'm sure that you've looked at data.
Yeah, sure. Look, if you look at the data, what has happened is for the larger companies, it's not a great area for the top 100 companies, because if you need to remember that where you have the promoter as the chairman, you already have 50% of the board comprising of independent directors. I don't have the numbers in front of me, but when we looked at it, it did not seem to be a large number which leapt out. In fact, it was a relatively small number in terms of companies where they will have to make this change.
Okay. Mr. Sengupta, under the group monitoring, essentially, it says audit committee can scrutinize use of funds by a subsidiary. Threshold for determining material subsidiary is now 10% of income or net worth. I mean, how significant will these changes be from what is done now, and how effective will this be in your assessment, briefly?
So I think it would be, put the spotlight on what has typically been a somewhat gray and nebulous area. And by defining the materiality of the subsidiaries in the way that the committee is recommending, I think what we'll find is that more companies will come in under the scrutiny in terms of looking at governance at a group level. And I think if you look at, you know, some of the recommendations which we have, including the formation, you know, looking at the group governance entity or the secretarial audit, if you may, for even the unlisted subsidiaries, we do think that in combination, this will create much greater awareness of the net financial position at the group level and create greater transparency around that relative to where we are today. I do think that this will be a material difference from where we are today.
Okay, Joydeep, as well as Amit, thank you so much for joining in.